I would give you the stars in the sky, but they're too far away. If you are a hooker, you know I'd be happy to pay. If suddenly you were a guy, I'd be suddenly gay. Cause my heart belongs to you. My love is pure and true. Community property. You're the only girl that I like to screw when I'm not on the road. When I come home, my dinner's made and the front lawn is mowed. I'll kiss your mouth even after my rocket explodes. Cause my
kind of, it's different a little bit, you know. So
yep.
So let me see, dude. Thank
can you hear me okay?
I hear you good. Can you hear me?
Yep, I got you,
dude. Thank you so much for bringing my wife up for Asian Hooker the other night.
That was fun, dude.
Dude, and she's such a
hater. I didn't know that was your wife. Yeah, dude. I had no idea. I was like, I found out afterwards because I didn't meet her till after.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Have I met her before?
I don't think you have met her.
I don't think I have.
It's been a long time since I've seen you. And then.
So I had no idea.
Oh, that's so funny. I thought you knew that. That's awesome. I was, thank you guys so much for putting her and my daughter on the list and everything. That was really cool hooking her up.
It was fun. It actually turned out to be a fun show.
Yeah. I'm so surprised. I saw it like a week before I had my New Year's gig in New Mexico and I was like, figures the one time I would go see a band in San Luis Obispo, because no one ever comes through here, you know. So I was like, fuck, it would be so great. And yeah, so that's good though. It was packed, sold out.
I wasn't sold out, but it was still way better than I thought when we were driving up. Because when we were driving up, I thought, oh my god, there's probably gonna be nobody there. Who the fuck knows us in San Luis Obispo?
No, they'd be talking. They were talking about it online. Like, they had a couple, like, there's a couple things I'm part of on Facebook and everybody was talking about it, so.
That's cool. Dude, good. That's awesome. Well, yeah, it turned out to be good.
Well, dude, I'm just going to jump into it so I don't take a lot of your time. So it's just a singing podcast. I'm not going to ask you anything, you know, personal or like that about your wiener or anything like that. So,
how big it is?
Has it? I don't know. Anyway.
How big it used to be.
When did you start singing?
I started singing pretty young. Like, I sang just in the car a lot, along with hit radio in Chicago. And I just loved all those songs from that era. So I would sing along in the car. And my uncle was stoked. He's like, oh, Ralphie, or whatever, Michael. Because, you know, my real name is Ralph. But he's like, Ralphie, man, he sings all the songs on the radio, man. It's so cool, you know? And my dad's – I'm half Spanish and half Swedish. So my dad's side grew up in Texas. So they have that accent. So
right.
Like, oh, man, they like to sing all the time. He's really good, you know. Come sing, man. So I would sing in the car. And then I got, like, not discovered, but there's a music teacher in third grade in the music – like, because you would have music class as part of the curriculum. And she was like, She's like, you can really sing, so let's work on that. So she would like, she actually helped develop my voice. Her name was Mrs. Williams.
So that was like your first like lessons.
Yeah, that was when I first really started to have somebody go, oh, you can sing and let's do this. And so she started like just having me sing songs in class, and then I did my first like school musical thing with her.
Right. Oh, that's cool.
And I was really, I liked her a lot because she was hot to me. And I'm not trying to be funny, Danny, for real. She was like, she was hot and she had like killer boobs. And I was like into that.
And you wanted to go.
And she also, yes, there was like more incentive than just singing.
Yeah.
And she also gave me piano lessons too as well, because my mom ended up hiring her to give me piano lessons.
And you play guitar, so, like great. Like you're like a great guitar player. I don't think a lot of people know that.
Thanks. Thank you. Yeah, well, you know, I really enjoy playing guitar. I really do. I enjoyed it so much until I met our guitar player, Satchel.
Right.
And then I realized, you know, I'm just gonna sing.
I did the same thing.
You know what I mean?
I did the exact same thing. I was like, I remember doing like a Groove Line gig with him. And I was singing it, and I was, you know, backstage, and he's just ripping, like, Darren's playing licks on the piano, and then Russ is just copying him on the spot. And I'm like, I don't really want to play guitar anymore. Like,
yeah, I don't want to play guitar. It seemed like it would be too much work.
Yeah, it's not fun anymore.
And not only that, I don't think that my fingers can do, I mean, thank you for the compliment. I can get around guitar and, you know, write some stuff and play, and I really do enjoy it, but that's just, and also piano too. Like, I took those lessons. And I learned like five songs, but I didn't learn how to read the music.
Right.
I just memorized them.
Right.
You know, because that's how it is for me.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. That's awesome. Now, so then from there, was Roth like your favorite guy? Because I remember driving with you to gigs when I would play guitar, and then you would play guitar too on the gigs, and you were singing. And I think you told me that Don Dokken was one of your favorite all-time singers.
Yeah, Don Dokken was... First it was Roth. Actually, like, let's go back a little bit further. Like, singer I really dug was Klaus Meine from Scorpions.
Right.
And then Deep Purple.
Inga.
And then it went to, from Deep Purple to, like, Loverboy. And then my brother played me Van Halen 1, and I was really into that record. And I dug the whole package of Roth.
Yeah,
you know, because he had the long blonde hair, he looked like a surfer, and you know, it was great. You know, it was he had like charisma and he's funny.
Yeah,
and it was rocking. And here's my son.
What's his name? For?
Oh, this is Michael Starr Jr.
Michael Starr Jr. What's happening? Yeah. Get the same hair. I love it.
Yeah, awesome. He ordered it up. Here you go.
But
yeah, that was like my lineage of influences and how it went down. But you know, like the other guys were great singers and they had great songwriting and stuff. But there wasn't, for myself personally, there wasn't that package of looks cool, killer songs, killer guitar player, and you know,
and that was
surfer, whatever.
Were you still living on the East Coast then? Or Chicago area?
Yeah. Yep. I lived in Chicago till 79, till Van Halen 2.
Okay. Awesome.
Yeah.
And then you moved out with your family, your whole family moved out?
Yeah. My mom and dad had they got divorced. They didn't tell me they were getting divorced, but they kind of split up. We went on vacation at my mom's sister's in Orange County in Southern California, and we never left.
Okay.
Yeah, and then my dad was never around. So I was like, well, I guess they're split up.
Okay. And you know, so it's funny. So you say, you know, cause you, Klaus Meine being one of your first ones, and Roth and Dokken. When you sing all these guys, because you were great at, you know, obviously mimicking Roth and everyone. Like I remember going to a sound check. I was doing a gig in Vegas. You guys were doing sound check, and you guys were doing Dokken tunes, and you sounded just like Don. Like,
yeah, That's another guy. Sorry to cut you off, but yeah, Don Dokken.
Yeah,
you know, he sang about like, you know, chicks breaking up on him and lying to him. He's a very sensitive singer.
Yeah.
And, but his, you know, his vocal technique was killer. It was very clear and kind of like, he had a really different style voice
for a rock singer.
Did you have to do different things? Like, okay, I got to do Roth, or I got to click, like, use a different muscle feeling in my throat, or different throat feelings, or is it always the same?
Well, that's why I like Don, because my vocal range as a kid was higher. It was I was a super high tenor, and my voice was super thin and clear. And to make it dirty, it took years for me to develop to be able to sing that way. Then my voice lowered and it was a little easier to do. But yeah, you have to like squeeze your throat, squeeze your vocal cords together and grind it out. And then right. For Don, you have to have you have to open it up smoothly and close it smoothly.
So when you sing like Don, like a lot of these singers that you, this is a question that someone sent in. When you're singing from the bottom of your range to your top of your range, you're doing different things for the different types of songs you're doing. So for like Don, would you say it's like your speaking voice just brought up as high as you can? And then
yeah, pretty much. For Don, you have to actually sing. If you're going to sing it like the record, you have to sing with proper technique.
Okay.
Okay, so you have to like use your air properly. You have to like take your time, take it slow, pronounce your vowels a little bit different. That's really, for me, it's really comes down to the pronunciation of each word. So like when you sing Roth, you're basically changing the pronunciation of words to make it sound like him, because everybody speaks differently and they all pronounce their words differently. For the most part, when they're singing, it stays that same way. There's stuff that just comes through in their pronunciation in the vocal. So with Don, it was very proper singing. Like his voice, he would pronounce you instead of you. He would say you.
Right. Real proper. Yeah.
Heart. And singing the word heart in a high range is very difficult.
Right. Right.
And Roth would go heart. He would just like push
it out.
So
it's kind of like a grip, like you're kind of gripping it right there. You're like, heart. Yeah. You're kind of gripping down. Do you, did you study when you got to LA? Because there was 1,000 teachers, right? There's a million.
I did. I actually did.
Who was that?
I was in a band with a band called Nightfall at the time, and that was like the original band trying to get a deal thing, and I started. We got a manager, and I don't think he liked me as a singer, so he got me lessons, and he got me lessons from this woman named Elizabeth Sabine.
Right.
And
yeah.
This, no. Do you remember that name?
Yeah. 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 Totally.
So she was. Coming off of teaching Axl Rose how to sing, and then GNR blew up. So yep. She was like the most popular vocal coach to go to.
Right.
And I drove up from Orange County to see her. I think she was in Sherman Oaks, if I'm not mistaken.
Yep.
And I would just go see her. And that was my first heavy metal training for singing, was with Elizabeth Sabine.
And did you keep a lot of that stuff throughout the years? You still remember, you know, do you warm up? Do you warm up with anything or?
Well, I remembered a lot of her stuff, and I used some of the stuff and technique that she taught me in my early days of singing. But you have to remember, back when we were playing in the original band, we'd only play like twice a month or maybe three times a month at most.
Right.
So, you know, singing was like, I never knew what I was going to get really when I started, because I didn't sing all the time.
Right.
And so later down the road, when I started working like we worked,
yeah,
you know, three or four nights a week, that's when I really had to get different lessons.
And who was that with?
His name is Bruce Extit.
Bruce Extit. I remember you mentioning that to me on a drive down to San Diego. We were talking about it, and you were like, you said the name, and I never knew who he was. Like, I never could find him.
Yeah, he saved my ass, because we had the gig at the Viper Room every week.
Yeah.
And then I was doing Atomic Punks on the weekends, and I had a day job. So I was doing the day job, the Monday nights,
yep.
And eventually my voice, I started losing it. Even though we had the cheaters,
yeah.
you know, having the samples behind us with the choruses on there and some other lead cheaters.
Oh, yeah.
I still was having trouble singing. So I went to my vocal doctor, which his name is Dr. Sugarman.
Yeah, I remember. I went to him a couple times back in
the day. And I was referred to him through Jack Russell from Great White.
Awesome.
So I went to see Dr. Sugarman, and he referred me to his protege, Dr. Nasseri, who was just starting. He just separated from Sugarman.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Started his own thing. Yeah, he's great. So he's been my guy ever since.
Oh, great.
But he stuck the thing down my throat. had a look at my vocal cords, and it turned out that I had acid reflux really bad. So when I would sleep at night, the acid would rise up and burn my vocal cords, and I would be hoarse in the morning. And that was pretty much from eating pizza after the show.
Yeah, well, I remember driving home from San Diego with you, and we'd always stop at one of those stops, and you would get those burgers in the, like the
AM PM burgers. Yeah, dude. They're good for you. And they're only 99 cents for two.
Yeah. That's so freaking funny. So the Bruce guy, what was the name again? Bruce?
Bruce Extit.
And he's really helped you a lot.
Yeah, so I got sent to him from Nasari's office, and I went to see him. And this is well, actually, you know what? I didn't have a day job then because this is right after we got signed by Universal.
Okay.
And we did our record. And you know what? I don't remember the lineage. I don't remember the timeline of it exactly.
Mm-hmm.
But I just remember that I wanted to see this guy, right? And he lives in the Hollywood Hills, right on the hill, overlooking the ocean. Not the ocean, but, you know, you could see the ocean from his window where you take the lessons. And it's like, okay, Ralph, why don't you sing for me? I'm like, all right. And I sang him Community Property.
Right. Awesome.
And I'm like, I will give you the stars in the sky. Right. And I'm crying it out. He goes, I'm so glad you came to me. You need a lot of help. I was like, wow. It like brightened the heart, just a dagger.
Really?
Fuck. All right. Well, and then, you know, looking back at that particular thing, I'm glad he did that because it, you know, it was one of those things where, you know, I've been doing it the way I want to do it for years and developing all these bad habits. And then, you know, I go to him and I sing in front of him and he's like, you need some help. Like you really do. It was an ego blow, but it was also like, all right, well, cool. Let's fix it. And it was basically like starting all over again because my voice had changed again in my late 20s. And by the time I was singing Steel Panther stuff that we recorded, I was like 35, I think. So my voice had changed.
Yeah.
And he really just hammered it out. Like he taught me a lot of important stuff.
Was it basically like going through scales, five tone scales and things like that, working certain vowels on scales, going up through certain.
Yeah. Actually, you know what he really helped me with was the transition from my full voice to my head voice, you know, so full voice is falsetto, and the transition between that, like the middle part, that transition was the part where I was missing. Cause instead of transitioning into my falsetto in a smooth way, I was just closing off and grinding.
Right.
And what that usually means, you're squeezing your vocal cords and your throat really hard and pushing really hard to get whatever sound you can get out, as opposed to just opening up and using your vocal cords the way they're designed to be used.
Right.
And so what we did is we, through scales and different exercises, the idea was to help me transition from full voice to falsetto without any like glitch or crack. Because usually, like, I don't know if you know what this sounds like, but for me, I would be singing and I would try to transition to a higher note, which would be falsetto for me. And it would kind of like blow out like a bad reed in a wind instrument. It would go and crack.
Right.
And so he was teaching me how to smoothly relax and go from full voice into this falsetto voice in a more relaxed state. And, you know, sometimes this would happen to me just naturally. I'd be on stage and I'd be really enjoying the moment, comfortable, not nervous. And I would just sing, and all of a sudden I could just sing super high. I was like, how the fuck am I doing this, right?
Right.
And then I would try and do it like just at home, and I couldn't do it. And I always felt like, oh, I got to be on stage. It's got to be loud. And that's the way I'm able to get to that note. But it wasn't. It was my technique.
So would you say, you know, like your falsetto, when you say your falsetto, did he have you do things like, woo, like things like that, like light falsetto?
Yeah, one of them is just a quick, and I do, you asked me earlier if I do warm up before shows, and now I do a little bit. And one of them is just taking an O sounding sound and bringing it from the top to the bottom. So you go, woo, right? And you could hear through that, what I just did through that, there was some cracks and
right
and whatever. And
then that smooths
out. Right. What I do for warm up is I keep doing that until it's completely clear and the transition is good. And that also gives me an idea. He taught me that. And also, when I do that before a warm up, that gives me an idea of what I'm going out and working with on stage.
Yeah. Well, I remember.
Which is extremely helpful.
Yeah. I remember driving home from a gig with you and we were talking about singing.
I'm listening. I'm grabbing a water. Keep going.
And I was like going through vocal problems. This was back, you know, in 2002 or something like that. And I was asking you questions and you said, when you wake up in the morning, you would do this little like squeak sound to know if you were going to be okay for that night. I remember.
Right. And you know what? That squeak sound, I don't have it anymore.
You don't have it
my
anymore.
Voice. No, it's gone. I can't. I don't have it anymore.
So, but that was I something. Used, yeah.
Right. Yeah. I'd be like, okay, that's it, man. I can sing tonight today. Right. I'll be able to sing tonight. As long as I can get that squeak, I'm good. Right.
Right.
And now I can't do the squeak anymore. So I think my voice has even gotten lower.
But you still do the Roth screams, like, which are insane. And that like when you're doing like the Cinderella type voice, that was something you always did really, really cool. And like you'll sometimes when you guys do, you know, your higher screams at the end, it's like, what is that? Like, what do you call that voice? You
know? Well, now that we've talked from the beginning to this, I can finally explain it, I think.
Yeah.
What it is for me is it's a falsetto note with grind, and that's all it is. It's very simple. It's a very light. It's not loud at all.
It's, watch it's you. Kind it's of like cake.
It's quiet. That's it.
And that's
so
it.
So it's falsetto with a tightening around it.
Right.
And that's what gets the vibration of the vocal cords to get that like screaming sound.
Yeah, and it works so easy for you. I remember doing those gigs with you, just going, you could bust into that voice, and it was like you could use that if you had a problem too with singing a higher part. You could just go boom right into that voice.
Yeah.
Boom and right out. Right.
Yeah, that's one of the things that was helpful in learning to transition from full voice to falsetto. And I also, you know who else I studied was Steven Tyler.
Really?
Watching him sing live, because he does the falsetto thing and grinds it up too as well.
Yeah.
And that's one of the, I mean, that's really the ticket. Now, there's one singer that is almost impossible for me to sing like, and that's Steve Perry. And I don't know if it's his head shape or what,
right,
but he was definitely an anomaly for that style of singing. And I can do it a little bit, but his falsetto didn't sound like falsetto. It's full voice.
Right.
And that's something that, you know, eludes me till this day.
So that was one of the questions. Someone said, is there anyone that you try to avoid, like have tried to avoid singing, or you go, God, I wish I could do that better, but that's just not my makeup. I just don't have that kind of thing.
Yeah. I think that you really have to know your limitations as a singer.
Yeah.
And I mean, I can get through it with a fake falsetto and eating the mic when I get up to a higher note and then bringing it back. So there's not that big of a difference in volume, but you know, it's really difficult to sing that voice.
So what about like your Roth voice compared to Michael Starr, to your sound, right? RALPH SAENZ, Michael Starr.
Yeah. There's through the years of recording records and being in the studio and hearing myself sing and developing these songs, I don't know if I've come up with my own voice, but I've noticed that I have my own pronunciation of words, and I think a lot of it is I have a Chicago accent still a little bit,
right,
mixed with a Southern California accent.
Right.
You know what I mean, bro?
Yeah.
You know, like Thousand Oaks or whatever. And I think that combination is what gives me my own sound, per se.
Yeah.
But, you know, I still like to, you know, there's nothing better than a David Lee Roth scream in a song. So I just fucking love to do it.
Yeah, I love it too. It's killer. How about some other questions? Right? Any diet? Do you work out? Any diets or anything?
Yeah. You know what? I just started doing taking some boxing lessons in the backyard, and I noticed your bag.
Oh yeah.
So we got a bag hanging in the tree, and
awesome.
Yeah, so that's been very helpful. But for me, mostly the most important thing is just hiking and doing core training.
Yep.
With a timer, because that really, like, after getting older, you know, I'm getting older.
Yep.
And
what are you, 26?
Just go out and
26.
I'm 28 now.
28, right? I missed your last birthday. I didn't mean that.
But you know, dude, that's all right, dude. I got the gift.
Oh.
But you know, I go out there and I try to sing, and I realize I'm out of breath. I need to pace myself better,
yep.
And I can't just go out and do it anymore. I have to I have to be physically prepared for it. So what that means for me is just working out with the core cardio. That's really important for me because you know, building up my core,
yep.
really helps support what I'm doing.
Yeah.
You know, especially it's moving around and
still jumping and around. Stuff. It's so hard, man. I've had two hip surgeries from those gigs.
Have you really?
Yeah. From all the jumping stuff we used to have. I don't think I could really think of that caused that. Yeah. I had tore like labrum twice.
Wow.
You know, and you do all the kicks and everything still. You're still doing all the kicks.
I can do the kick, but I can't jump and land anymore because it hurts so much.
Yep.
What's up? What's wrong with it? Yeah, go for it.
And any diet?
You know, I just, it's AMP diet is diet. Yeah, dude, I just had burgers yesterday for dinner. Cheeseburgers, but I made them on the grill. So they're way more healthy.
Not the AMPM ones. Those are
But either way, you know, food, I try to eat, you know, as best I can. But for the most part, I love to eat, man.
I'm with you.
You know, and our bus is usually filled with, you know, cookies and chips and pretzels.
Yeah.
And then there's yogurt and fruit. And that shit goes bad right away. But pretzels and pizza, they always taste good.
Oh, yeah.
They taste good in the morning. It tastes good before you go to bed. It tastes good when you wake up to go pee. They're always good.
Dude, that's awesome. Let me see. I think that's it, man. I don't want to take up too much of your time. Anything you want to say to any singers out there? What they should, maybe a little road to travel? What they should do, something that'll help them?
Well, you know, if you're doing a gig, the best thing to do, and you're going to go out and do a group of songs, and if you don't do it all the time, you just need to sing your set. And that's where that core workout comes in, because when I like to hike too. And when I hike, if I'm walking up a hill or whatever the hike, when it starts getting strenuous, I like to sing. And then I'll start running and singing at the same time because it helps stabilize the note.
Right.
You know, because I like to move on stage. I don't like to stand there too much. So if I'm going to run and sing, then I got to practice doing it.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And then also another thing too I like to do is practice. I did a lot of mirror training. And what that is basically like, you know, practicing your boxing in front of a mirror.
Right.
Well, you do the same thing. You approach the gig like a fight. You know, I'm going in. And I need to be mirror ready. So I need to know what looks cool, what doesn't look cool, and what moves I can actually do that will translate in front of an audience.
Right.
As far as my perception is concerned.
Yeah, yeah, no, absolutely.
And I've also gone to the lengths of videotaping myself moving on stage and then, you know, doing the YouTube research and checking out moves.
Yep.
And I've slowly eliminated a bunch of stuff that I feel like doesn't look that cool for me.
Right, 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 right.
Not to say I've ironed it out. But another thing too that's really helped out is yoga.
So you do yoga? How often do you do yoga?
Yeah, yeah.
How often?
Yeah, not too much. Well, I just learned some moves from an app called Swerkit that has yoga moves in it. And that's what I do. And I have like a 21-minute trainer that I use. And it's mostly core stuff. You don't need any weights for it. You know, I can go to any gym and do it.
You gotta send me that. I wanna do it because I'm always getting bored. I'm always trying to think of new workouts.
Yeah, it's cool. It's cool. I have like I think it's 16 exercises in it, or 20 maybe.
Yeah, and send it to me.
I have it I will. I have it sent on random. So you know, you never get the same thing over and over again. So you always break a sweat. It's got stretching in it, and it's really good for me. I like it.
Okay.
I think it really is helping for the show.
Yeah, I think so. I think that all that stuff, especially that running in the hills and stuff like that. And then as you start to get out of breath, keep running and singing like that.
And sing. Yeah, that's really good. That helps stabilize. And also the work on your technique and not tightening up. Because mostly when I used to get tired on stage, that's when I would lose all my technique. So the best way to ensure from that is to do cardio and keep your core in shape.
Yeah.
That will enable you not to get out of breath. You know, because there's going to be shows where you're going to be tired. There's no way around it.
Think of like, and you guys have done it like Aspen when we play.
You come out
like an animal and then like, oh crap. I can't breathe because I can't sing to breathe. I'm done in a song and you got to like kind of bring it back slowly.
Yeah, that's the worst.
They had the oxygen backstage. They used to have the big oxygen that. At the belly up. Yeah.
Yep. That's the hardest thing is singing in high elevation, like Mexico City.
Yep.
You know, Denver. Those are really difficult gigs. And also Vegas. Like just going to Vegas for a one-off.
It's dry.
You get there and it's so dry. Or Phoenix. You know, those are.
Steaming or anything like that? Do you do steams and stuff?
You know
like
what
that?
I'll do? If it's super dry, I will just, when I'm in my hotel room, I'll turn the water on hot and just leave it on.
Leave it, yep.
And let the whole room steam up. I've done it so much that it's set off the fire alarm.
I've done the same thing. That's so
funny. Right?
Yeah.
It works great.
Yep. No, that's...
You know, hot tea. Try to stay away from any, like, nasal congestion stuff, like Sudafed, when it's dry, because it just makes it worse.
Right.
So the best thing to do is drink as much fluid as you can. Water is the key. I try to drink up to about 3/4 of a gallon of water a day. And this is my first one.
Yep. And so that's
32-ouncer.
Is that, that's key for you. So anything else like key for you, like any lozenges or anything like that that you mess with? Or
Not really, man. I mean, I just really focus on keeping water in my body and keep myself hydrated and rest. That's like the key.
Yeah, you get a lot of rest.
Rest is really hard to come by on the road too. You have to, when we first did that first record, we were going into radio stations and doing morning shows on the road to try and promote the band. Because that's what you have to do.
Yep.
And I would have to sing Community Property. And it was like, it was hard, man. I had to really learn how to sing that song at any time of the day after just waking up. And after 8 years, I can do it now.
Nice.
Almost any time.
Yeah.
For the most part.
That's awesome, dude. And what about, you have any, you want to send anybody to websites, certain websites for you guys? It's just steelpanther.com. Is there a Twitter? Do you have a Twitter or YouTube?
You know, I have, go to Michael Starr on Instagram. And it's Michael Starr with 2 R's. You'll know it's me because when you see it, you'll go, oh, hey, what's up? That's Michael. And we also have Steel Panther Rocks, which is our main website.
Okay.
That has all our dates and everything. And we're on Facebook. All you got to do is punch in Steel Panther and you could just go into a rabbit hole and just gets kind of sucked into watching it.
Okay.
Kind of like you would do with any band. You know, you just go watch as much stuff as you want.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm probably going to put some, a clip of, some songs in the beginning of this thing and at the end of this thing. So any songs I should put up there? You want me to put up there? Any certain?
Well, definitely Community. I would put like a song from the first record and something from the last record, because I feel like my vocal style has, I don't know. I feel like my singing technique has gotten better since the first record. I feel like it has.
Okay. So you want to put a live thing up or go grab a studio clip?
Yeah, that Community Property clip. I think my voice has changed dramatically. If you listen to like Community Property on Feel the Steel and then listen to Wasted Too Much Time on Lower the Bar, the difference is, I think, pretty amazing.
Okay, so maybe I'll put those two clips, one in the beginning, one in the end. That'll be cool. And thank you.
I feel like, hey, the most important thing for a singer is to be able to take direction from a guitar player and the other guys in the band and grow as much as you can. Because that's the, you know, you have to develop your talent as you get older.
Yeah.
And you guys try and do the, you know, be as good as you can be. It's not easy.
And it's amazing, you know, watching you guys, you know, being, you know, acquaintances and friends with you guys, watching the transformation over the years. Like, you're like, it was such a cool transformation. And you guys just keep going and going and going. I'm like, it's not going to stop. This train's like, it's going full force. You know what I mean?
I hope so, Danny. You know, Yeah. We're going to ride this wave until the swell is over.
That's
and awesome. Hopefully it will be us dying, hitting the rocks or something, you know?
That's great.
Oh, hey, one other thing I forgot to say is cocaine's really bad for your voice.
Really?
Yeah. Yes. And singing drunk is really bad for your voice.
I know that.
That is like the worst because you don't feel what you're doing to it. And if you have more than one date in a row or, you know, you're on a tour, it will fuck you up for the whole rest of the tour. And you don't realize it till you're in it and you can't sing.
It's such a and you know, it's not bad like once in a while to have that one that's kind of gets you a nice buzz and then you're really having fun because it will bring a little bit more out of you. At least someone like me probably.
Yeah, it does.
Like you've got the thing. And but yeah, if you go one overboard, you're screwed.
Yeah. Dude. Not only are you hungover, your voice is hungover. Yep. Like, oh man.
And then you got to do it again. And then if you have to do a morning show or something, like you guys got to do morning shows and meet and greets. So
we try to wait until the guitar solo before we start doing blow.
That's smart.
That's a responsible singer.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah. So then there's not much left of the show. You only got a couple more songs encore and you're done.
Yeah, but if you're really taking your craft serious, I would steer away from crack, cocaine, and heroin. Those, I mean, just stick with a few beers. Stay away from the nose beers.
Maybe a little weed. You know? Maybe a little weed.
Maybe a little weed, as long as you have a prescription.
Right.
You know, you're cool. You can carry weed here in LA now, so that's cool.
That just passed, right? 2018, it just passed. It's so funny.
Yep.
What a goof.
I know, right?
Dude, well, thank you so much. The listeners, they're gonna love this. I hope I hit everything. When we talked about technique, you did study, you did all. So that's killer. That's what they all wanted to know.
Yeah. Okay. And then we should do a recap, man. Down the road.
Let's do it. Let's do it when you come back from the tour and see how you're feeling.
I'm in. Awesome. I'm in, dude. Let's do it.
For taking care of my wife again. That was she had so much fun. My wife, my daughter.
You're welcome. You're welcome, man. Well, good to see you, Danny.
All right, man. I'll talk to you soon, Roth.
Bye.
Later. Yeah.